You're listening to episode 55 of the D6 Podcast.
Here's the encouragement I give you. The shortest distance between your child's heart, your grown child's heart, and Christ is you.
Parents need to own that they are the primary disciplers of their child.
Our goal in parenting is not for our kids ultimately to get a great education, as good as that is. Our goal is not for them to be great athletes. Our goal is not for them to go on great dates and find a great husband or a great wife. Our goal is not for them to have a great career with a great job, making great money. Our goal is for them to love a great God.
You're listening to the D6 Podcast. Here's your hosts, Ron Hunter and Jeremy Lee.
This is the podcast that helps you build an excellent family ministry in your church. Ron, how are we doing today?
We're doing well. I'm just getting in the rhythm here. It's a good thing they don't have video on. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, they were just doing a video of us, and it's probably not going to be good.
No, it's not. That's why we're only in audio form on a regular basis. At least I'm only in audio. You're allowed to be on camera.
We have faces for radio, my friend.
Yes, we do.
Now, the one thing I am glad that they're starting to video in here, because this studio continues to look amazing. I'm now looking at, we've got panels with D6 on them over here. This is getting more and more professional every time I show up at this place.
So why is it that we have a TV studio and we're doing podcast recordings?
I don't know either. Are we about to be live broadcasting? I don't realize it.
Or maybe there's hidden cameras that we're unaware of.
Your team, you never know what these people are going to do.
They are talented. They just set me behind the microphone, and then they come around. You saw this before we got started. They came around and adjusted my microphone because I didn't do it right.
That's right. Well, hey, look. I was in a staff meeting one time. This is the worst transition ever, but I'm doing it. I was in a staff meeting one time. And the pastor said, this is when I was on staff at a church, he said, hey, we need to work on special needs ministry. We need to do better, and I want a staff liaison for special needs ministry. And Ron, I've never seen so many heads fall down and duck down and try to hide in a meeting. Nobody wanted to be the special needs liaison because there are so many unique challenges that come trying to serve and help families in your church that have special needs, especially with kids who have special needs. And the reality is, when you get assigned that task and it's your responsibility, you want to find a friend who knows what they're doing. And we have that friend today.
We do. In fact, you know, the real scenario of what you just described is all the heads bow and they duck out. You know who usually steps up? The family who is actually working with special needs 24/7 in their own home.
Yeah.
And they don't get a chance to worship. And so Marie's really going to come in and address that. So tell us about Marie, our guest today.
Yeah, I think this might be my second or third. It's at least my second. I think it might be my third time to interview her. And she always comes with tenderness to her interviews and care. This is not someone who's doing this out of any sense of obligation. It's out of passion. It comes from the story of her own son, Nathaniel. And so there's a lot that she has to offer. And this particular interview is my favorite, though.
Yeah,
and I'm happy to say that because I wanted us to go very particularly into the needs of an autistic child at church. Because just to be honest, a huge percentage of the special needs kids that are in our churches, the special need is autism.
Yes.
And that is one of the more prevalent things that churches are having to help and foster and encourage, especially children's ministers. And there's a lot of different elements to this. By definition, autism is on a spectrum. And so I wanted to address the different sides of the spectrum and the different angles to the issue. So this is one of those that a minister wants to keep on file, because I can't imagine there's not one of you out there who doesn't have at some level some dealing with an autistic child or an autistic family. It's too prevalent now. Most all of us in ministry are going to be dealing with this.
That's right. And I will tell you, before we get too far in, if you've already gone, hey, I don't have any families like that in our church.
Shame on you.
Well, exactly. Number one, maybe they don't feel welcome. Maybe it's not ministering. But I will tell you, the one thing I hear Jeremy say a lot is look for transferability in our podcasts. You might not be dealing with families with autistic children, but the topic that Marie's going to address in dealing with parents, you can apply apply to other parents who are going through difficult times and listen to the ministry applications of this.
Yeah, and if you don't have special needs families in your church, we all think as ministers, no matter how you feel about it, a lot of you think in a growth mentality. You're like, how can I grow? How can I get more families? We want to reach more people in our city. You know, this is shooting fish in a barrel right here, because by definition, special needs ministry is meeting needs.
Yes.
And this is one of those things where word will get around fast that this church actually cares. This church actually wants to give us a break and wants to help us out, and they don't grow weary of us, and they aren't trying to avoid us. They're actually inviting us. We're in, and this is one of those areas where I've said this all along, all of these ministers are killing themselves just trying to grow their attendance by 10%. Well, you know what? You do things like this, that's you grow by 10% pretty quickly.
Yes, you do, and it is a challenge. So I'm looking forward to hearing Marie. Marie is always a blessing to us. And as, before we jump in, let's remind our listeners, as we move into the summer, we're only going to do our long interviews.
Yeah,
and,
a little format change.
Yeah, a little format just for that. We'll pick back up in the fall, both the long and the short. So today, we're focusing exclusively on Marie.
Yep, and after the break, we'll be hearing from Marie Kuck, and she'll be talking to us about how to minister to the parents that have an autistic child.
What's it like to be a member of the D6 Leader Network? Well, what if I told you that you could hire an intern for your ministry that would plan your sermon series each month and create amazing graphics to help promote it? What if that same intern helped you train your volunteers by writing an online teacher training every month that includes a fully produced video without you even having to touch it? What if that same intern created a fully designed parent resource that they can actually use to help them spiritually lead their family? What if that same intern was able to get you access to every main stage talk, breakout, or interview D6 has ever done at their D6 conference for your own training and development? That would be the best intern in the history of the world, right? Well, becoming a member of the brand new D6 Leader Network is like hiring an intern to do all of that and more for around $1 a day. We make your life easy. We make awesome easy. If you are a minister, you can go to d6leadernetwork.com to learn more.
Well, I love it when I have a guest that I interview so much that I get to call him like an old friend.
We are old friends now.
There we go. And this is Marie Kuck. And Marie, you have been with us, and you work with special needs. You help churches connect with the special needs community through your organization that you co-founded, Nathaniel's Hope. We're not going to go into it today because we've gone through it before, but the story behind Nathaniel's Hope is so beautiful. I hope folks will, even as we're listening to this interview, pull up the website. It's nathanielshope.org. It's beautiful, the story. It honors your son, and it's just gorgeous. So thank you for being with us today.
Thank you.
And as churches are engaging this idea of special needs and helping special needs families and really connecting to them, you know, there's a lot of different special needs, but I wanted to focus on one today that we hear a lot about from ministers that they won't help with this. We're going to talk today about how to minister to the parents of an autistic child. And now autism is one of those things that is more prevalent than folks might realize. In fact, I looked up some stats on this. 1 in 68 children has an autism spectrum disorder. Now,
right. That's amazing.
Let's talk about this.
Yeah.
What is an autism spectrum disorder? Let's start with that, because the idea of the spectrum is really important, isn't it?
It is. Well, so, you know, let's start out with, it's kind of like a brain disorder that has manifests in a wide variety of different ways. But typically, it might hit a child's language and communication ability, their social skills, maybe their imaginative, creative play, you know, in those ways. You may see it manifest in a lot of different ways, which is why there's a spectrum that you could have kids that are high functioning or kids that are very low functioning. For instance, kids may have motor skills that they struggle with, so it might be hard for them to tie up their shoelaces, right? Or they might have social skill issues where it might be hard for them to make eye contact with folks. Maybe it's going to be hard for them just to communicate, or maybe do something as basic as go to the store and buy a piece of candy. You know, it could be very, very, varied like that. Very, very varied. But on the other side of it, you can have kids that are on an autism spectrum that are extremely high functioning, that are brilliant. They may lack in their social skills, but they are brilliant. I have a lady that worked in our office for years, and she had a daughter on an autism spectrum. And do you know, she took her the SAT test for the first time and got a perfect score. It was amazing. Wow. But her social skills really lacked. She had a hard time connecting, you know, with eye contact or communicating or having friends or anything like that. So it's a very broad, it's a very interesting disability that has a lot of different implications to it.
Yeah, absolutely. And here's another thing I learned. Autism is one of the fastest growing developmental disorders in the U.S. And so that sounds to me like their churches all across America are going to have families in them that are dealing with this issue of autism. So let's get into it with a church specifically. How can a church specifically minister, not just to the child, but to a family that has an autistic child in it? Because there's a lot of things they struggle with.
Right. And so you bring up a really good point. You know, families impacted by a disability, families impacted by autism, it affects the entire family. It doesn't just affect the child. You know, it's not just finding a place for the child, but it affects the family. It's how the church receives the child impacts the entire family, right? So I think, you know, one of the first things that we have to do is ask ourselves, is a church being intentional to welcome families that have kids with autism? Autism, you know, sometimes because the churches are afraid of what they don't know, they may not intentionally push their hand away to welcoming a child. But many times, you know, parents are just wanting their kids to belong and be like any other child, right? So when it impacts a family, we want to be sure that churches are very intentional about saying, you are welcome here. We want you to be a part of our community. Your child, though, may have some differences that are maybe different from the typical kids that are here. We want to find a place and figure out how to work with your child, you know, within our ministry setting. And that might take some work for a church to do, because if you have a child that has unusual repetitive behaviors, you know, or may have outbursts, or may just not even be able to connect like other kids do, we need to look at these children and make provisions for them, you know. For instance, a child that walks into a church setting that might have a lot of stimulation and a lot of sensory could throw a child into sensory overload, right? So we need to be sensitive to that and make a provision to say, okay, this child with autism, the way they receive these sounds may be offensive or harsh to them. So how do we equip them with something like earphones, or how do we maybe redirect their path on a Sunday morning to a quieter place, you know, and take them out of a place that might be cause disruption in them because it's too much stimulation for them, you know. But it's a church thinking through these things and working with the parent to find a place for their child to belong. That's very important.
I love that. So we know that children who have autism, sometimes they struggle in a group setting, and you've given some of those. But what are some of the things that we can anticipate and address when we have, because a lot of, especially children's ministries, will have like a group, at least some element of a group setting,
right?
And there's usually children with autism that have very real struggles in that particular setting.
Right.
So what are some of the ways we can help with that?
Well, I think it's important that you help the other children understand that maybe Johnny has autism. He has an autism spectrum disorder. And what does that mean, you know? And how...
That's okay to talk to them about
that?
It's not embarrassing?
No, and you should do it in front of the child and not, you know, not pull all the kids together and say, hey, Johnny's not here. Let's talk about Johnny.
Johnny's not here. Everybody gather around.
Right. But it's a way that we help them understand. So Johnny, you know, may struggle with noises. So let's help Johnny, you know, let's help Johnny. And if there's a loud noise, we may need to give him some earphones, you know. Or sometimes if Johnny may need to leave the room if there's too much interaction or too much, activity in a room. And sometimes Johnny may need to leave the room because this is hard for him to be in this setting. So we want Johnny to be a part of our church community, but this is a way we can help him, you know. So we want to help kids understand why he may get some special privileges, you know, or do things a little bit differently, but it's going to help him to belong because he belongs in the community. We need to help kids understand that Johnny is part of our body, you know. He's a very important part of our body, and we need to make provisions for him to be here, you know.
Yeah, but let's dive into that a little bit more. Like, do we seek Johnny's permission? Do we seek the parents' permission to have this conversation? How do we set all that? How do we set that moment up? Because they're is a potential for insane awkwardness in the midst of all that,
course,
right?
Of course, yes.
So let's talk about that.
So I think that, you know, you are on the team with your parent, right? You don't want to, this is not parents against the church, you know, but we want the parent to know that Johnny is so welcome to be here. We want him to be part of our community. So we want to create an environment that's going to be the best for him and to make him feel like this is his community. So I think we don't want to ignore the elephant in the room. The elephant is Johnny's got autism, right? And that's no newsflash to anybody. But we want to help. We want the parents to be part of the solution and helping to educate. So sometimes maybe even a parent might come in and educate and help them understand, you know, first of all, starting with the Sunday school teachers or the children's workers, you know, about what they're about autism and particularly how it relates to that their individual child. Because you can't quite say, here's what autism is and this is how you work with it, because every child is different. A child that is in a higher functioning spectrum, they may have a better job at running audio equipment or something, or having a job that a task that they can serve in some way and kind of be to themselves and have a specific task and really enjoy that. Where a child that's a little bit more low functioning, that wouldn't be a good setting for them, you know. So it's actually working with the parent, you know, just say letting the parent know that we want your child to be here and how can we make a provision. Let's work together to make this a win-win for you and for us.
I love it. Okay, so another thing I discovered, yes. See, in all my research here.
You've been doing research.
I feel
You've
like
been
I'm
busy.
An autism wannabe expert right yes. now after all this. But is it true that boys are nearly 5 times more likely than girls to have autism? And I think that is true. So how does that fact impact our ministry to families with an autistic child?
Right. So you said earlier, you gave the wonderful statistic, 1 in 68 children are typically diagnosed with autism, which is blows my mind that it's so high.
Yeah.
So out of that, it's like 1 in 42 are boys. Like 1 in 42 boys are diagnosed with autism, where 1 in 89 girls. So there is a difference, you know. So I don't know. I mean, I think within the church setting, you know, I mean, to me anyway, kids are kids. And I think...
But maybe you need more men than you might think in this particular struggle?
I think in all cases, we're always short of men in kids.
Yeah, pretty much everywhere. Agreed.
In kids ministry, right.
I think we can get an amen from everybody on that.
But I do think, though, for reasons... So you have boys with a higher, you know, the higher number or percentage or whatever. But I think the men, if you're needing to have some arm power maybe to help, that's a good thing. I think because of the high divorce rate for families impacted by disability, having father figures is a good thing to have in the church, you know. So I think for that reason.
Pause for a second.
Yes.
High divorce rate?
There is. So there's an unquantified number. I can't say who put out the statistic, but there is a number that floats around that 80% of families that have kids with special needs end up in divorce.
Oh, my goodness.
It's a very high number. So the need for the church to step in and to help these marriages succeed is critical. It's critical. It's one. It's 90% of families that lose a child, you know, couples end up separating. So it's pretty amazing. I'm in that 10% tile there. But the church has an opportunity to wrap their arms around this community and help them to succeed in that, you know.
Well, that screams to me that if I want to be involved in special needs ministry, then I've got to have marriage ministry as part of that, right? We got to find a way to help that.
Absolutely. Which is why, you know, churches providing respite care is so helpful, because it's giving families a break and allowing maybe couples to get time together. So, you know, you hear about seminars out there saying you have to, you know, you have to obviously have good communication. You have to have time together. You have to have time to build that love relationship, you know, with each other, right? When you have a child with special needs, and particularly sometimes kids with autism who may need a little bit more attention, you know, because of behavioral issues, you know, that's very hard. That can be very hard on the marriage, you know. So anything we can do to help support that marriage, you know, as a church is really pretty critical, you know.
Wow, I don't think I understood that statistic. I mean, it makes perfect sense
high.
When you think about it. Let me ask you this, because if I'm a minister, especially a children's minister, and I'm trying to understand and discover special needs, I think, again, that awkward moment, what system do you recommend to churches that they put into place to give families the opportunity to communicate our child has special needs? Because like we talk about with autism, there's that high functioning autistic child. Well, you know what? We may not understand that they have any kind of struggle. So how can we prepare or set up a situation where it's easy for for yeah. parents to communicate that.
Right. That's bingo.
Bingo.
Make it easy for them to tell. Like, you know, a lot of times parents don't want to tell because they feel like their kids are not going to be welcome if they find out that they have a disability.
Make it judged, yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so I think, you know, pretty much in, you know, when you have registration forms or, you know, forms about your child, just ask a simple question. Does your child have a special need? You know, is there anything that we can, you know, help with? Does your child have an IEP? That's an individual education plan. So if they're in the public school system, they're going to have an IEP. That's a simple question you can ask right away. If they say yes, then you know, okay, there's some kind of issue here that I can follow up now, and I can go to the parent and say, hey, tell me about this. You know, how can we help you? Because we want your child to succeed, and we want them to learn, and then we want them to grow, and we want to spiritually minister to them, you know?
Okay, so is IEP a pretty universal term?
It is.
So,
yes.
Okay, so if in my entry form, because everybody has somebody fill out a form.
Yes.
If we were to put on there, does your child have an IEP?
Yes.
And if so, explain.
Yes.
That would be a really easy way for
very
them to.
Very easy way. You know, or you
without
could
saying, is something wrong with your kid?
Exactly,
you know?
Exactly. and then follow up, you know, within, you know, pretty quick. In a day or two, I would follow up and say, hey, I noticed that. I'd like to learn more. Tell me about your child, you know?
Okay, and just rewind real quick. IEP stands for?
Individual Education Plan. Individualized Education Plan.
I think that's useful. I think somebody's going to hear that and say, okay, now that's a way to say it.
Right.
Respectfully.
Right, respectfully, right.
Okay, perfect. That's really, really good. Okay, so I want to talk to you about if an age-graded minister suspects that a child might have autism but have not been diagnosed yet, which a lot of especially children's ministers might find themselves in that situation.
Sure.
How do you handle that? How do you handle communicating? Because you don't want to just, again, call up the parents and say, I think something's wrong, and then because I can only imagine if somebody did that to me with my kids, I'd be super defensive.
Right.
How do we handle that?
Well, yeah, and because you've got to remember, it's not our job to diagnose. You know, it's our job
sure.
to love them to Christ. But there are times parents are in denial. Like they may see something, but they don't want to really admit it. And here's the deal: if their child is in a public school system, teachers are going to notice things, and they put children through testing, right? But if they're not, if they're homeschooled, if you know they're not in a public school system, it's going to be a little bit different. I think the way to approach is to go to parents and say, you know, I've noticed that Sammy has, we've been seeing these kind of behaviors. Have you noticed this, you know, and how do you handle that, you know, and just kind of try and open up a dialogue with the parents. I wouldn't say, you know, I'm seeing these behaviors. I think your son has autism, you know.
not a way to approach
right.
that.
But to just kind of, again, you're on the team of the parents and recognizing that a lot of times, you know, a life of a parent, particularly a parent with autism, you know, we talked about how the spectrum is so wide, you know. I've talked to families before that these parents just don't have a normal life with their children, you know. So I'm going to give you an example. A season like Christmas, where it's so much joy to have Christmas and to celebrate, it could be a nightmare for a family that has a child with autism because of all the stimulation. I had one mom tell me, I dread Christmas morning. It doesn't matter. I give my child a present. They don't have any clue that it's Christmas. Emulate the joy. They don't understand. They don't connect with it. You know, she goes, I just as soon not have a holiday. I just want to get past this time, you know. Mm. It could be very difficult. You have kids sometimes, and this is maybe on a lower functioning side of autism, that have behavioral outbursts, you know, and the kids and parents, I've had parents that have to lock themselves up in the closet or in the room and to call for help because they can't, single moms, that their children can overpower them, you know. Those are real issues that parents face, you know. And again, a lot harder when it's in a single parent situation. I'm not saying that's not all kids with autism because it's a spectrum. So that can be a spectrum. You've got parents that deal with the fact that their children don't have friends because they don't have good social communication, right?
So I imagine that is an issue,
it's
right?
It's true, right? So as a church, how do we help facilitate relationships or at least try and pull in a child that is not connecting in with other children? You know, it doesn't naturally happen. And of course, other children don't know how to pull in a friend that doesn't really act like the other kids, you know. But these are all very much hard, painful things for parents to undergo, you know. So just understanding that, you know, can help you look at a parent with compassion or a family with compassion and maybe cause us to go the extra mile, you know, to reach this family and to minister to them and love them.
Well, you know, you saying that makes me think about the siblings.
Yes.
Some of an autistic child. What are some of the ways we can reach out to them, or what are some of the struggles that a sibling might face
right.
that we might not think about?
Right. Well, I think, you know, one of the natural things is, I think, you know, with kids, when they become self-conscious that their brother or sister is different, you know, that their sibling is just not like everybody else. And sometimes kids can be cruel and they can make fun of something that they don't understand, you know. And so there might be a reluctance for a child to even want to bring a friend home, or maybe they can't even bring a friend home, you know, and have a typical relationship because they don't know how their sibling is going to react, you know. I mean, that can be very hard, you know. I think in a church setting, I think anything we can do one-on-one, sometimes we think it's just a child with autism or a child that has a special need that we really need to focus on. But you're very right when you say the sibling. You know, we need to maybe give extra care to a sibling.
I guess it's its own special need.
It is its own special need. You know, and oftentimes parents have to give a lot more attention to the needs of the behaviors that autism may bring, and sometimes maybe the sibling can get left out as well, you know. Mm. So,
well, okay, Marie, as usual, you've done an amazing job, but I don't want you to leave without talking to churches about how you consult with them, help them. Sure. They don't have to do this alone, and that's the whole point of Nathaniel's Hope. They can contact you,
yes.
and you can help get them a system and plan together so they don't have to just do this. Because churches, I know their hearts are pure, but sometimes
right.
they're clumsy, especially in this area,
well,
and they need help, right?
Yes, and do you, I mean, where in school do you learn how to make this a part of your ministry? It's really not part of our educational institutions, right? So you have ministers that are trying to meet a whole spectrum of needs within their congregation or in their children's ministry. So special needs is very specialized. So we want to help churches equip them to do what we believe the church wants to do, and that's welcoming and be intentional about welcoming kids with special needs in.
Okay. Well, listen, guys, if you're going to ever outsource and invite a consultant into your church, I think this is an area where it would be totally worth the investment. So please take time to check out Marie Kuck's ministry and learn the story behind Nathaniel and why it's called Nathaniel's Hope. You can go to nathanielshope.org to check it out. And again, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Hey, Ron, Father's Day is coming up, and you guys are producing something that churches can hand out to dads on Father's Day.
And make it really easy and affordable. So what we've done is we've taken all of our D6 family titles, or some of the best, and we've extracted quotes from the various authors and assembled it in one little booklet. It's about 32 pages, full color, and it's affordable, and it's a size dads would actually read.
It's called A Father's Legacy. I've actually got a copy of it in my hand. It looks great, graphic designed, and it's just a gift book kind of thing. And in the front, there's a place where it says a gift for and from and date where you can personalize it. If you're a youth minister, you can get this for the dads in your ministry. If you're a children's minister, get it for the dads in your ministry. Or you can just buy them in bulk for the whole church, right?
It's very affordable to do that. So the price point, if you bought one, is $2.99. But buying them in bulk, you can buy 10 or more for $2.69. Or if you're buying them for $100, it's $1.79. We have price points all along the way in between.
You can buy them on the d6family.com website. It's right there on the store. You said they are in limited stock, so they need
That's
to do
right.
it if they're
going
to do
That's
it.
That's right. They're going quick, but you know, once they're out, we're out. So please call and order them. These are so inexpensive, but so good looking. People are buying them in large quantities. Call our 800 number. Check on inventory immediately. That's 1-800-877-7030.
All right. Happy Father's Day, guys. I hope you enjoy this resource.
All right. I tell you what, if you want to know more about Marie, go out and Google Marie's interviews she's had with the news media. I watched a television's news station in Central Florida cover one of her events where there were, I don't know if there are hundreds or thousands of people gathered for a walk and to raise awareness for this, but it is incredible. She and her husband, what they're doing to raise the awareness of churches to focus on this need and raise the awareness of parents who are going through the challenges of this aspect of raising children with special needs.
Yeah, as you heard in the interview, Nathaniel's Hope is the organization mm-hmm. that Marie has founded. Again, please look it up. You will not be sorry. And yes. as you are dealing with special needs families, not dealing with them, as you are serving them, just know D6 is here to help you. They've kind of got a partnership with Marie. She's kind of their voice in this world. And so contact them and ask for help. This is one of those areas where it's just smart to ask for help. And encourage you to do that. Now, I want to shift, Ron, on the way out.
Yes.
Because you just mentioned to me before we got started, we were talking a little bit off air about that you're booking speakers now. You're conversation for D6 Conference 2018, which September 20th through the 22nd.
That's right, in Dallas.
In Dallas, Texas this year.
Yes.
So I think it's cool. It's a cool time of year to be talking about that because we're only a few months away. People are probably starting to think about the fall.
Yes.
And
yes.
What are some speakers that you're excited about? Well, give us some behind the scenes scoop for our listeners.
Absolutely. You know, when we think about our speakers, we currently have, I believe, 44 booked. And before we're done, we'll probably always tend to hit that 50 mark.
Wow.
So as we wade into this, know that this is just a sampling of the people that we're going to hit. Gary Chapman, a big name, been around a long time, but that message. You look up on the best-selling books, I don't care when you come. I've been at Randall House and D6 now for 15 years. And when I came, the five love languages were in the top five books being sold. You pull up the top sold books, his book is still there.
Yeah.
That's how the longevity of this. And he's going to be talking to the marriages in the room over these areas, reminding us of those fundamentals of the five love languages. Dr. Richard Ross, he has taken a sabbatical. Everybody knows Dr. Richard Ross. I mean, he's taken a sabbatical, a whole semester off where he has been writing, I think could be his best book he's ever written. And he's written some really good ones. And he's going to release some new insights for the ministry leaders and for the families in the church from student ministry that he believes, and I agree with him, could shake up how student ministry is done. And he's going to be delivering that from main stage. And I'm not going to deliver the content because he will deliver it far better than I will, but I know what he's writing about, and you do not want to miss it.
I had no idea he was taking time off. See, this is the kind of juicy tidbits.
It is.
That you get when you listen to the D6 podcast.
That's right. Now, the theme this year is the 1 over 168 t-shirts that we've always worn. Not the t-shirts, but the fraction.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody knows what that stands for. 1 hour of discipleship out of 168 hours in the week. And the reason being is, people have trusted the discipleship entirely to the church. 30 minutes in a message, 30 minutes in a small group, be it Sunday school, life group, whatever. And that's all they're getting because the church is doing things with excellence, but the home is not delivering on discipleship. So we're going to emphasize messages, whether or not they're through a lens of the church ministry leader or through the lens of how can the ministry leader help parents continue discipleship. And so our entire minis this year, which are those small 12-minute talks, we call them D6 Ministry Talks, minis, and all of them are dedicated to the home as well as other main stage topics. And included in that, we have Dr. Timothy Paul Jones, who the number one question we get in family ministry, what about the kids who come whose parents aren't showing up? They don't even come to church. He's going to address that topic. Christina Embry, she's going to be dealing with how can I fit one more thing into my schedule when I'm expected to be this discipling parent, and she's going to give that practical side of how does it fit naturally into your schedule for you to equip your parents to deal with that talk from a mini standpoint. And we've got others such as Joshua Straub. We've got Dr. Laverne Tolbert, who did the book Teaching Like Jesus. And, of course, we have the skit guys coming back and the people who are going to guide us. Yeah, Tommy Swindle and Megan Marshman. I mean, they're going to help us on this journey. So that's just a small sampling.
What about music? Do you know who's doing music?
Yes. Matt Papa is going to be doing music.
Oh, Matt Papa's coming back. Don't you love Matt Papa?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
Yes. So he's going to be a big win because he's only been in Louisville. He's not been in Dallas before with us.
Oh, cool.
Yes. So big deal there. And there are a number of others. I'm working on a couple of others I wished I could say, but until you get a contract, you know, and they've agreed, you don't want to throw their name out there.
Okay.
We've got one that's a generational connect. Actually, two. One's a generational, two generations putting them on the stage at the same time if this works out, and another who has conducted a longitudinal study over 40 years.
Wow.
And I'll just leave it at that. That probably is enough of a clue for anybody paying attention to know who that is, but
we'll go ahead and tune in next week, and Ron will be announcing Billy Graham speaking at the D6 conference. That's not, you know, that's no, not, oops.
Yep, that's not.
Wow.
That, yep.
My bad. I'm just kidding. So, but you will let our D6
we
podcast
will,
as, listeners
yes.
be one of the first to know, right?
That's right. Absolutely. Perfect.
Well, hey, you guys, thank you. I hope this was a helpful episode for you, not just getting some inside scoop on the D6 conference, but hopefully you are inspired to look at your special needs ministry for the fall as that's coming up, and maybe you can be a little more inviting and helpful to the special needs families in your community. Please, mental note, every Tuesday we drop this podcast, and if you are not subscribed yet on iTunes, it would be awesome if you would do it. If there is a place to leave an honest review, and we love that as well, that always helps us. More people kind of hear about the podcast when you do that. So if you have a few minutes to do that, we'd be very grateful. But either way, thank you for listening. And let's talk a little bit about next week. We have Brian Siewert.
Cool accent guy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And his topic is, I think, an interesting topic. How corporate should the church be? I'll talk a little bit more about that next week, but this was one of those topics that I intentionally brought up with him, and he teaches a seminar on the subject, and I really pushed him hard in the interview. I don't think he really liked me very much because I was really mean to him during the interview, but that's okay because we wanted to get a great piece of content for you guys, and I think it'll be challenging all the way around, no matter what kind of church you're a part of. So we'll see you guys next week. I hope that was enough of a tease, and we appreciate you listening. Please remember next Tuesday. See you then.
You've been listening to the D6 Podcast. You can learn more about D6 at d6family.com. And if you're a minister, we invite you to join the D6 Leader Network by going to d6leadernetwork.com.